In the high-speed arena of cybersecurity, where precision and strategy separate the victors from the vanquished, there is a figure who dominates the digital landscape with the skill and finesse of a champion race car driver on America's most iconic tracks. This is the story of Andrew, the undisputed nightmare of security operations centers, SOCs, a maestro of the cybersecurity circuit with over 2 decades of experience in his rearview mirror. At the core of Andrew's expertise is his mastery in deploying comprehensive offensive security strategies, managing vulnerabilities with laser-like precision, and crafting robust application security frameworks. He's a virtuoso of social engineering, slicing through defenses with the precision of a scalpel, reminiscent of a skilled driver navigating the twists and turns of a racetrack. His approach seamlessly integrates sophisticated exploitation platforms, enhancing digital security while also elevating design processes, operational efficiency, and consistently setting new industry standards. But Andrew's skills transcend mere technical prowess. He doesn't just scan for vulnerabilities, he exploits them. In the cyber race where every millisecond counts, Andrew is a maverick with a formidable grip on the virtual wheel. His approach to a network isn't just an intrusion. It's a calculated strike with the precision of a seasoned race car driver feeling out the perfect moment to make a move. Picture the scene. Andrew revs up a distributed denial of service DDoS attack, a barrage that blazes across servers like a smokescreen at the backstretch, distracting and disorienting the competition. It's a tactical feint, the roar of engines masking the real play. As security teams scramble, Andrew slips through the chaos, his eyes not on the mayhem he's orchestrated, but on the prize, the database, the silent trophy awaiting its victor. With the deftness of a driver drafting behind a rival before a slingshot pass, he deploys malware, a silent assassin creeping through systems undetected. And then, with the database in his grasp, it's as if he's pulled the e-brake for a drift, swiping the data in a fluid-controlled slide that leaves no trace but the scent of victory. He's gone before they know it, slipping away with the payload while the DDoS still rages, a cunning distraction that left the door wide open. In the cyber realm, he's the ghost racer, the phantom trailblazer who's outpaced your every defense, and just like on the track, when he takes the lead, it feels like he owns you. In this high-speed duel of wits and wills, Andrew is king of the cyber circuit. Always one move ahead, his victories measured in data exfiltrated and defenses bested. With each campaign, he reminds the world that in the Grand Prix of Cybersecurity, he's the one holding the championship title.
We are bringing on Andrew. Andrew has one of the most interesting James Bond type of positions in cybersecurity. He's been in the industry for a long time. Andrew's specialty is social engineering and offensive security. Andrew, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Sure. I've been here for about 20 years. Pretty much worked everywhere from radio stations, cell phone companies, and counties. And now I'm at an MSP.
It's interesting because I see a lot of people that go from like MSPs to the county. You went from the county to the MSP.
Politics.
Interesting. Very interesting.
So a little fun thing in the county world is don't know more than your boss.
Politics, that's, yeah. I get that. So what you do, like what you do today, you are the self-proclaimed SOC nightmare, destroyer of networks. There are a lot of people that fear somebody like you coming into their organization. Why should a lazy IT manager fear you?
Well, it's not the lazy ones I actually really like going after. I like going after the arrogant ones. They're the most fun.
Okay. I get that.
The best one that I did publish it on LinkedIn for at one time. I think it's still up there too. The SOC nightmare came because the way that I do like a red team engagement is I'm going to get in. I really don't care how I get in, but I'm going to get in. So a lot of times it's either playing policies against the companies, like, because I know most of the policies. I know most of the standard policies and what they're going to say and how they're going to act. The other thing is I like using a lot of distractions. So it's really a cat and mouse game if I'm on a network.
Okay.
So the particular one was the CISO came to me and told me to do basically a red team, and I decided I was going to do it by myself because he said, "Hey, you can't do it." So I'm just I, my response was, "Okay, let's go." I mean, he had a massive setup. He had remote SOC. He also had an in or in-house SOC.
Okay.
Fully staffed IT team, everything. And I think his IT team was just the repair side was like 20 people, and then the SOC was another like 20 people plus the outside SOC. So they had a pretty good sized operation.
One versus many.
So that one was kind of fun. I started off with a whole bunch of OSINT. So I scrolled through their company Facebook and LinkedIn, and I found a light. There was always a light out in one of their pictures. It was just in a hallway in the lobby, but the light was always out. So when I was growing up, my dad was an electrician. So I used to work electrical all the time. And so I understand it. And
Yep.
it's pretty easy. Well, at least to me. And then what happened was is I walked in there as a repair guy for that light.
The old
So,
contractor trick.
well, whenever I get tired of doing IT, like every like few years or so, I'll break off and go do electrical work or, just go do something different. I think one year we turned our farm into a commercial farm. Did that for a while. It's mainly just, you get tired of staring at a screen.
Yeah, no, I get it.
And so at that time it was I was work I did a union or worked with a union shop. And so I had all of their jackets and stuff and shirts and stuff still. And so and they were actually on one of the jobs right next to this place because they're building another like or they're building another dealership right next to it, and they were out there. So I had a place to park and everything, and I could walk in and out of the job site just unnoticed because
Yes.
I had the vest. So I'd park the truck over there, and then I'd come over, and then I went into the building as the electrician to go fix that light. Had the ladder, the light, and everything. But what they didn't know was this is where I started the plan. So I went in there with an external battery and a little Wi-Fi pineapple section. Oh. Yeah, there it is. Yeah. This one actually.
That's
And
pretty good.
then I also had one of these little guys. It's just a Raspberry Pi in a nice little case.
There we go. It's one of my favorite tools.
And so, and I had battery. Well, it was a battery pack similar to like that.
Yep.
So I threw those up in the ceiling as well.
Nice. And then you left them.
Right. So I played the whole, I have to go get parts. I'll be back, tomorrow or, next day. And so I let them run. But the fun part was, is I have this big giant alpha card. It kind of looks like a lightsaber.
Yeah.
It's, and you can put different antennas on it and get more or better range. So I'd go out into the next parking lot and sit in my truck with that Wi-Fi card, and I was connected to the Pi into the pineapple.
Yeah.
So from there, I got on their Wi-Fi network, The problem with their Wi-Fi network was that it is obviously just is Mac or it had Mac address on it, so or Mac blocking. So it is basically the only thing that could connect to that particular network was phones. And so I was on there. I started, you know, playing with ARP requests and seeing, and finally I actually found a couple of MAC addresses that I could see, and so I spoofed them.
Nice. As my university had MAC address filtering when I was there, and every device that I had on the network was a Nintendo Wii, and I had a lot of Nintendo Wiis.
So, and that really only let me go so far. I mean, they had it locked down, you know, couldn't do VLAN hopping or anything like that.
Okay.
So then, so I go back and I noticed that there's a data jack behind the plant. They had a plant in the lobby and there's a little data jack behind it. So I was like, yeah. So I go there, I set my tool bag down and I plug a Pi into the little jack and it was active.
Nice.
So I'm sitting there, I'm going, well, I'm on. So I left the Pi there in the plant. I was like, meh, if anyone sees it, they'll see it. If not, yeah, then we'll just sit here. We'll be good. So from there, then I went back to my truck and I connected to that Pi with the wireless cards. And so from there, I started, you know, doing the normal thing of scanning, trying not to get caught. And then I found their SOC server. So I'm like, this is going to be fun. And that server actually held most of their SIEM database and everything else. So it was a nice little find.
There you go.
So this is where the plan got kind of fun is. I knew I wasn't going to get directly in. Because obviously they're going to see me.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, their SOC could see if you ran in map. So.
Yeah, so they're monitoring in real time. So you have to look like something that's legit in order to go unnoticed, kind of hide in plain sight.
Right. So usually in that situation, what I do is I will either run under DNS ports or act like a DNS server, or I'll do some other things like I like making fake gateways, things like that. I'll force clients through me, and then I'll start filtering out traffic just for the fun of it. Things like
nice.
That.
Nice. There you go.
And then, so I thought about it for a while, and so I figured out what I was going to do is I was going to take down their SOC. Because if their SOC is down, then I have free reign of the whole network.
Yes.
So I ended up basically DOSing the server, which got them kind of like, hey, what's going on? Because their server kept failing.
Yes.
And then I, from there, I grabbed some, it's a common problem I find everywhere, and it's funny as crap because it's enabled by Windows, like default. I mean, not many people disable it, and not many people know how to turn it off, but it's the whole LLMR and ARP poisoning problem that, you know, Windows has. So I started grabbing a bunch of hashes, and then I started playing past the hash. So once I found a service account, and I got the hash for a service account, and so I was able to start actually accessing pretty much any machine I wanted to.
Nice.
And because I didn't even decrypt it or anything, I just sat there and played past the hash all day.
That's crazy.
So I ended up starting putting mock ransomware on all of their SOC machines.
Nice.
So now I had all their security department worried about their stuff instead of the network stuff.
Yes.
And then, yeah, from there, I just started taking over everything.
Nice.
I think I ended
locking them out of all their own devices.
Yep. I locked down their network, changed, I locked out their CEO, all kinds of stuff. And then I pulled a crap ton of data. I think I pulled like almost like 4 terabytes, 5 terabytes of data. And that was really only because that's all I had room for at the time.
That's crazy.
And then I called the CISO and I said, "Are you tired yet?"
That's funny. That's funny. So he thought his SOC was saving him. He thought his SOC and his remote SOC was saving him.
Well, that was the funniest part about the whole remote SOC. So it was actually connected to that server that I DOSed.
Then that was the only way that the remote SOC was monitoring was through one single server.
Yeah, which kind of surprised me too. So
it doesn't surprise me. A lot of times you see a whole lot of sophisticated this and that, and then, you know, feeding it is some piece of bullshit.
And so then at that point, I was pretty much, you know what? I called him. I was like, "You tired yet?" He's like, "Is all this you?" I was like, "Yeah, it's all me." So I killed the stack or the attacks and then reverted everything back to him for him. And then he was comes back and I had to do the closeout meeting and he didn't make eye contact at one time during that closeout meeting.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
And it's like, just remember this is it, and then, you know, the typical why we, or the whole question of could this really happen in real life? I'm like, well, if they wanted it bad enough, I suppose.
Yeah. I mean, when somebody wants it bad enough, they're going to get you. I mean, that's the way I describe it. I say, look, a bank can be very secure, but if somebody wants to drive a semi truck through the door, they can. Like your users have access and they need access. So somebody has access, but you always have to be aware of, you know, which digital assets do I really need to protect and how do I limit my access and stop it? Like to pull all that data from them, like did you do it through like CEO's account or something like that? Like somebody who should have had access?
No, so the service account I ended up getting was actually their backup account.
Oh, wow.
I didn't know it was their backup account. They were pretty good about account randomization. Okay. However, but it had file privilege. And that's yes. Really all I needed.
So that's really what you were looking for.
Right.
Yes. Yes.
So as soon as I had that, I had access to their database and everything else.
Have you ever ran into a situation where you couldn't do it?
Not really. So if I can't do it by technical means, that's when I start real heavily on social engineering.
Social engineering. This is an interesting one. Social engineering, because the weakest link in any system is the people, right?
Yeah, and sadly, LinkedIn and Facebook are probably the best tools to find people.
I agree. And they're all on LinkedIn too, but LinkedIn makes it so easy to track.
To me, even nowadays, even with like the AI replications for voice and video is so much easier.
Oh, it's insane. If I had it fired up right now, it's not running. I have real-time deepfake that runs on 3090 that I have over here.
Yeah, I have it on the back of this machine that I'm talking on right now.
That's cool. And every like 2 weeks, these tools get better and better and better and better. And it doesn't take like a cluster of high-end stuff to do it. Like you can do it with open source software.
See, now we can depend on software. Back in the day when I first started this stuff, we had to basically find either know how the guy sounded like over the phone, or we had to play it off like a bad connection.
Yeah, no, I get that.
The worse the connection, the better off you are at that point.
He won't care, but I had hockey player Darren McCarty on a podcast. I cloned his voice out of the episode and used his voice for the intro. I did it using 11 Labs, not open source, but use open source to do it so easily. The technology is insane, but like all these other countries, these hackers from other countries understand how to use it and are heavily invested in it, and their English sounds great now.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's the way I've always approached like pen test and red team is I don't really hold back a lot because my theory is if you're going to actually get attacked, you're going to actually get attacked. They're not going to care.
Yes. Yeah, no, your adversary in a cyber war or when they're trying to steal millions of dollars. Like the reality is these are types of crimes that you go life in prison for. If you do things like this, like doing crimes with a computer, they're a serious criminal when they're hacking you and stealing databases and identities. Like, yeah, they don't care about your feelings.
So, I mean, that's the way I approach it. And sometimes it's like, especially social engineering, I feel bad. I think one of the recent ones, it was actually at a company's main office, which I really hate doing main offices. Because it slims down the chances of social engineering like crazy.
Why is that? That's interesting.
Partly because that's usually it. So what I find out is wherever like a main person is, like a CEO or, you know, like a main staff manager or something like that, they're usually a little more protective in that building. And this one, I actually ended up... So part of my thing is because I worked telecom forever. I still do occasionally. I go fix phone systems and stuff for people.
Just, there you go.
Just because. Partly because
everybody needs help, and I'm sure you probably set a lot of people up in the day, and they still call you.
Well, I mean, I still have a couple of contracts out where I've quit several times and they still send checks. And so I'm kind of obligated.
That's nice. That's so nice.
I stormed out of the door saying, I'm not doing this anymore. We're done. And then the next month I get a check in the mail. I'm like, damn it.
That's funny.
And so I have a few customers that are still like that. So, but. No, back in the day, I had my own MSP, and we did mainly networks. Like, we did integrations for, like, Spectrum. Well, back then it was Time Warner. So if their engineers couldn't get something to work, then they would call me. And so we were doing all kinds of weird things. Like, when they first came out with SIP service, we were able to get SIP service to work with, like, old analog T1 systems.
Yep.
And... things like that. And so I've always known that. But in that process, I collected a ton of shirts. So I have, you know, like I have Spectrum shirts. I have AT&T shirts. Yeah. I have Comcast shirts. And what I found out is usually if I can find what their IP address ranges are, I can find out, obviously, who their provider is.
Yes.
So I go in there and... as whatever provider they are, and I'll make a service ticket. Like I have a whole bunch of service tickets that look just like what that company would send out. So, you know, I change the address. I change, you know, whatever we're doing. Sometimes I can find their circuit IDs. So I'll even put their circuit IDs on there.
That's funny. And honestly, with these big carriers, like if you don't have an independent agent, you don't know your agent, you're getting a random person every time. And your team doesn't stay the same. There's so much turnover at the carriers. The carriers are a weak link in a lot of these hacks. almost every time.
Yeah, so like I said, sometimes I feel bad when I have to do it. Like I think one of the last ones I did was I felt super bad. It was a nice old security guard that walked me into the IT closet.
Oh no.
Okay.
Oh no.
And I felt so bad because I had to make that report.
Yes.
I'm like, it's like, dude, it's like I want to tell him, but I can't tell him.
It's not, it's the thing is though, it's not about getting that guy in trouble. It's about, the social security numbers of all your employees don't get leaked, right? That's what it's about, protecting that data. And I guess in this industry, the ends do justify the means, because it's the only way that you can prepare for something like that.
And then there's the times where, like I've walked into an office and like no one is there to greet you, so you just have free rein.
Yeah.
I have a whole series of selfies from a bunch of social engineering events where I just walk to a random computer and I'm sitting at it and I take a stupid selfie with the computer behind me.
There's a racetrack that I work with, and I didn't have credentials for one of the events, and I was walking around. Everybody would ask me, like, hey, what are you doing? I say, I'm IT, I'm watching the internet. And I'm just walking around everywhere. And there was one kid that stopped me. There was one guy that stopped me that was like, no, you can't be over here. You gotta get out. But almost everybody, hey, I'm IT. All right. But nobody questions you.
And so, yeah, I've always found it easier to go in as a carrier
Yeah.
because no one questions the carriers. If you go in as like an IT or like, like a Cisco dude or something like that, they're gonna find out.
Yes.
I mean, the other good one is food delivery. Food delivery always gets you in the door.
That's
Doesn't
so funny.
So, go get your little Chick-fil-A costume from eBay or wherever.
That's funny.
go buy like a little catering dish and walk in the
Fake DoorDash.
building.
That's crazy.
So.
I never thought of that one.
It's kind of stupid, but it works.
No, if it works, I mean, if it works, if it works, it works. And you'll see in like some buildings, like federal buildings, it's like no questions asked. You're just out. There's no conversation. Nobody talks to you. They've got a process.
I think it's like the old days. The old days I used to hit up smoke pits. That was always my favorite thing. You'd
Yes.
go to the smoke pits, you go sit there and strike up a conversation. When they start walking in, you start walking in with them, and there, you're there.
Let's tailgate them.
So,
So you're just blending in. You're just going and you're blending in with anybody that's there in some way. You're trying to look like you belong. You're going under the radar. You look very, very much like you're supposed to be there. Are you like studying these places way before you go in, or it's easy enough that you have a technique that just seems to work?
depends. So most of them are pretty easy. Like scarily easy.
No, it doesn't. It does not surprise me, but we should talk about that. Like, how often do you see no network segmentation? How often do you see like default logins?
Well, I mean, I deal mainly with the financial and medical sectors, so I mean, those are usually pretty covered pretty well.
Okay.
They're also monitored pretty heavily, so those ones we don't play too much with the networks. I got in trouble for, you remember when Fortinet had all those CVEs open not too long
Yes.
ago? Well, fun fact, the FDIC uses those in on all
There we
their
go.
clients.
There we go.
We had it in scope one day, and so I hit it and I broke it, and yeah, I caused lots of trouble.
Good thing it was you and not somebody else,
Well,
because anybody could have
my
done
only
it.
defense was it's in scope.
Yeah.
I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, it's bad when I pen test place because I constantly have to ask someone how far is far enough.
Yes.
Because it's like, I've already compromised them. How far do you want me to go?
What's the farthest somebody's ever let you go?
I've taken down networks before.
Completely.
Yeah, so like financial side's kind of weird because we mainly deal with like a CISO and they have to have uptime and all that stuff. So
Yes.
we can't really destroy or break anything.
That's no fun.
Medical and large corporations are a little bit different because they really don't care.
That's crazy to me.
So like medical is kind of fun because, well, most EMR software sucks.
Agreed.
So, I have an ongoing fight with one of the EMR vendors for an old client that they're not sending stuff to the database encrypted. And they're like, well, we're not doing anything wrong. I'm sitting here, I'm like, but you're responsible. It's like it's like this network that is on, they have their own CA server, every client has a certificate, the database is connected to it. I mean, everything is SSL and TLS on that
Yes.
network. And theirs is the only thing that's not encrypted going across that
That's
network.
re that makes it so obvious.
And so I get onto them and they're like, oh, well, you just have to run a client to server VPN. And I'm like, we're not doing that. You know how much overhead that is?
That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous.
And so, yeah, it's been an ongoing fight with them. I'm just like, at some point, you're just like, you know what? Fine, whatever.
Who's auditing them? Letting them send like HIPAA data
Well, and
unencrypted.
that's the bad part is, they have all the HIPAA certifications and stuff, and
Blows my mind.
last time they threw that in my face, I was like, yeah, I'm HIPAA certified. What do you want?
That's so crazy. I talk a lot about compliance. What's the difference between compliant and secure? There's a big difference between compliant and secure.
And their big thing is like, well, HIPAA doesn't say that you have to encrypt traffic. And it's like, but here's the thing is most other frameworks do. So like NIST and ISO says to say that you have to for that type of information or for identity or PII, period.
Yes.
And so now you're dealing with PHI, which means you're not encrypting it, so we got a problem. And that's nice. I sent them the PCAP files. It's like, hey, here's all the hexes. Break down the hexes. Here's all your data and verbatim. There's
That's
patient name. Here's everything.
crazy. That's
And
so crazy to me.
so yeah, it's been a big fight with them, and it's pretty much beyond frustrating with that. But they're not the only ones. That's the sad part.
Yeah, no, it is. It is. And sometimes like these systems, probably the ERP stuff, this is a software that's been, passed down, passed down, passed down. I was just at Michigan Tech Conference not too long ago, and one of the big topics was talking about open source and how people are using open source to achieve security, because a lot of the closed source stuff is not being updated on the back end by the developers.
Right. And that goes on like a couple of things is what I find out is I found out like that particular company sold and now they only have 30 support people servicing everything.
Yes. Wow.
So I would be more, I wouldn't be as upset except for it's one of the major vendors. So they own probably about 60% of the share
Man.
of all company EMRs.
That's crazy. Dude, so it makes like it makes me question where I go to the doctor. Like it really does. I've never had my identity stolen, but like what some people don't realize is when all of this information is leaked, like that is something that impacts a community for a very, very long time. it's not just, oh, haha, we got hacked and we got fined. It's all of these people, you know, that have attended your clinics and your office, are their information's out there and it's getting stolen, and there's more damage that's being done long term just because people don't care.
Yeah. Well, I've always had this notion that, hey, my information's already out there anyways somewhere.
Yeah.
So at what point do you stop caring, you know?
I don't know. You, my opinion, obviously, yeah, there's a lot of information out there, but if you can take those couple of steps just to make it that much harder to get you, you might get glossed over. You might get glossed over, you hope.
Yeah, but here's my problem. I've already known my stuff was out there because a few years ago I filed my taxes and I had the, hey, you already filed your taxes.
Nice.
The hell nice. I did. And so, yeah, that was a mess.
From a young age, I've always been careful about the information that I put into computers, knowing damn well that that stuff sits on servers forever and doesn't go anywhere.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I still have stuff from, you know, 20 years ago sitting on a file somewhere.
Yeah. It's crazy, but that's a lot of these companies, too. They've got databases that go back forever, and they just collect all this info and just let it sit here unencrypted until someone grabs it.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I mean, I think it's getting even worse now with everything being, you know, on the web versus being closed.
Yeah, not even, I mean, the other thing too is the stuff isn't even getting leaked on the dark web anymore. It's getting leaked on the main web. It's getting leaked on, you know, .coms, not .onions.
Yeah, but most of the, but then again, you know, most of the major break-ins haven't really been technical break-ins. They were just social engineering.
Yeah. Yeah. So, employee training, the most important part.
I mean, that's what I always say, and people get mad, is, you know, it's, employees are the problem.
Yes.
I don't know how to tell you anything else, but...
Let me ask, do you find that it's more so like leadership is the problem, or like newer, more entry level employees?
Here's the thing with that. Right now, it's a little more easier. And I don't mean to like touch like politically or anything. I really don't give two shits about politics, but what it is, if you're not getting paid enough to live anymore, why do you care?
I know exactly where you're going with it, and I agree with you. And a lot of times it's somebody from the inside, isn't it? Ransomware as a service.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I did that as an exercise for one place. I pretended like I was nefarious and bribed somebody to put some software on their machine as a social engineering test.
No way.
But again, I felt so bad because, I mean, obviously there were some repercussions to that person, but it was like...
Oh, there was some repercussion, but that's the person that was going to turn you over to Lockbit. Let them go at it. That's the person. That's the person that one day sits around there watching the news. I can get $1 million for at my company out, and they're not supposed to pay it. And they do, like, Change Healthcare, almost positive somebody paid that because there's 23 million in Bitcoin that went out.
So Change Healthcare, that thing, I'm pretty sure that at this point it's just hactivists. I mean, Alphabet probably took credit for it, but I'm pretty sure it was another group.
Interesting.
I know that sounds weird, but it's because of what they attacked.
Why do you say that?
Because they went mainly after billing.
Okay. Yes. Yes. Okay.
So like me in my mindset, if I'm going to hack somewhere, I'm taking everything down.
Yeah.
I don't care.
Yeah.
That's just me. But if you're targeting a specific thing inside of an organization, then that falls into like a hacktivist or
yes,
somebody with that problem.
Yes. Yes. somebody was specifically upset with their billing, or they didn't want them collected on medical debt, whatever it was.
Yeah, I'm fine with that. I hate being like that, but you know, I'm fine with it.
Yeah, it's nobody feels bad. Nobody feels bad for them, do they? Nobody feels bad.
But on the other side, they set themselves up for disaster when all these companies sell to each other or buy each other out and merge and become one giant big company. That's where the problem starts. Because that's when you start having people not realizing what their job duties are or what they're supposed to cover or who to even talk to half the time.
Yeah, no, it's...
But then
I talk to a lot of companies. They don't know who's in charge. Who's in charge of the security?
But then But then you go back to that. Hey, you go back to that level one IT guy that's making, you know, $16 an hour that has a family to feed. He's not going to get about where what's happening.
No,
he's just there to close tickets and go home.
Yeah.
So, I mean, in reality, that's what it's come down to.
Yeah, it's a lot of times it is an inside guy. It's someone taking care of the ransomware as a service that's out there. There are platforms that are built around just giving your access credentials to, you know, one of these bad actors who's going to hack them, and maybe they'll give you the Bitcoin, maybe they won't. Maybe some of these people want the money, maybe other people are just mad at their employer.
But the thing that makes me the most mad about a lot of these large ransomware attacks, though, is a lot of it could have been prevented with training and policy. And then on top of that, have proper backups.
What is training, policy, and backups cost?
Nothing compared to a ransom.
Nothing. I mean, reality, okay, your backups are going to cost a little bit of compute power and storage, right? That's nothing. Go get spinning disks if you need them. If you train your employees, there's free resources online. It's Google, YouTube, stuff.
Or, you know, you run like a small company, you know, with a small IT staff. I mean, IC Squared still has free CC certs.
Yeah.
I mean, and you can go get a free cert for security. At least you learn, I mean, IC Square is mostly over policy, but at least you learn that function.
Yes.
Or at least the start of that function.
Yes. I mean, some people don't think about it at all. A lot of people think my IT is taking care of my security. They have me secure, which is so backwards because security is a personal endeavor and everybody has to do it. It's everybody's job to do it.
Well, that and a lot of these companies look at security their own way. So what I've noticed is a lot of people look at security as a cost center, which it is, but it's not at the same time.
Interesting. Why do you say it like that? Is it because you it's more of a necessity, you need it, or?
So the way I look at it, all right, yeah, it is a cost center because, you know, security people aren't cheap. I get that.
No, especially in recent years. The price is going up because the banks keep hiring all of them.
So what I find is, like, a lot of these smaller companies, they try to save a dollar or two by offloading it to, like, an AI tool or whatever new tool that was sold to them. Yes. You know, I could pay $40,000 a year for a tool or pay this guy $80,000 a year. Which one do I want?
Someone's got to run the tool.
No, it's point and click now. Come on now.
Yeah, someone's got to run the tool. Someone's still got to run the tool.
Yeah, but C-suite doesn't understand that most of the time.
AI, it'll do it all. No, it won't. Really good AI will do 90% of the job. A really good one will do 90% of the job. And that 10% is critical.
Yeah, it's like one of the problems with AI is you can usually trick it.
Yes.
Because of the way it responds.
Yes.
I mean, it's like when everyone started putting the AI chatbots on websites, you could sit there and find out which ones were like ChatGPT, which ones were, you know, like some in-house version of it, which ones were like Llama, and what, you know, I mean.
Who are you? I'm ChatGPT, created by OpenAI. I'm a large language model. Here you go. Let me cost you some API credits.
So, I mean, when there was a couple of car dealerships, you could go and, you know, say, hey, I got a free car. See,
you know, I saw that. It's not hard. It's not hard to jailbreak these things. The other thing, too, with the open source stuff, you can download an open source AI. And just for fun, I was asking it just to see what these other guys are doing out there. And this was a regular Mistral AI. So a llama based AI. I asked it. I said, how can I hack my local medical office? And it rips through the details. It says, hey, befriend the doctor. Do that. And it talks about social. It gives you the step-by-step. And I looked at that and I said, wow. Wow. I know a lot of medical offices around here that could get taken by that easily.
Well, it's a... I don't know if I still have a video of it. I used to have it up. I can't remember where. I think I took it down because I got a nice email for it.
We'll see if we can find it. If we can find it, we'll put it up.
But what it is I made OpenAI into a hack box.
Nice.
So you just log into it and say, I want to run scans on this IP address. Okay. Or say, would you like me to run this command? So you did, yes. And then do it for you.
That's funny. If you didn't clear your history, if you did it in the GUI, it would still be there. I asked it one time. I said, look, I want to demonstrate a weak password for a cybersecurity lab. Instruct me on capturing handshakes and using Jack the Ripper to crack the password. And it walked you through, and I said, I'm an idiot. Give me the step-by-step copy-paste commands for my terminal. And it sure as shit gave me step-by-step how to do it. I think it was wrong in one spot. And I fed it the screenshot back of the error, and it corrected itself. So it was... somebody who had the idea that they wanted to crack a Wi-Fi password could have done it.
I hate cracking Wi-Fi passwords. I really do. They take forever. It's like, I have this machine sitting by me that has 4 NVIDIA cards in it.
Which ones?
They're old Tesla cards.
Okay, nice.
So... I mean, they work. They're a little slow nowadays, but it's the machine I actually use for a lot of AI stuff and messing around with AI.
Nice. What's your favorite open source AI tool right now that you've been messing with?
I can't really tell you what I have on
public. That's funny. That's funny. Okay. what's a fun one that you can talk about that you like?
I like the llama ones pretty well.
I love the llama stuff.
I mean, that's really the one I play with the most. There's been a few more.
Do you mess with lava at all? The multimodal vision?
No. I had one, I can't remember the name of it, but it was specifically for hacking. It was a cybersecurity one that somebody designed.
Hack GPT or fraud GPT, maybe.
I really don't know what it was. A fork of something, and I still have most of the database. It got corrupted when my NAS died. So,
bummer.
Then it? Do have the video here. Let me share the screen.
All right, you should be here. Yeah, I just turned your sharing on. Now you should be able to share.
There we go. You should be able to see my.
There we go.
Yeah, so I actually saved it on Google Drive. Yeah, so it's a short little video. Sorry for all the noise. Air conditioners are noisy.
I can't even hear it. So you're hitting API here, it looks like.
Yeah.
Scan.
Yeah, so it makes the command and then it asks you to execute it.
And map knife. Nice.
That's what it did. Yeah, so there it's wrote in.
So it'll run and map for you.
You can run it on a search plate, so that's what that one is.
Nice. Search exploit. There you go. Nice.
And then you can make it run Metasploit.
That's cool. That is so cool. Backdoor command execution Metasploit. No way, is this all running in ChatGPT? How does this work? Or this just connects to Metasploit?
So the computer itself has it, and then it's linked to, I had an old OpenAI library that was jailbroken.
Nice.
So I took all of, pretty much any of the stuff that keeps you from doing stuff like this off of it.
Yeah, it took all the limiters out.
So, I mean, you can ask it to do some things, but yeah, so yeah, there it is. It popped it up. It's just a little Metasploitable box that was playing.
That's really cool. That's super cool. So, I mean, I don't think we're too far away from a lot of this, you know, stuff being significantly more automated, but it's not, you know, it still takes somebody with some knowledge. But do you think it's like lowered the barrier, like for people that want to hack and do stuff like that?
Oh, it has. I mean, it's sad a lot of times too, because I'll ask it, hey, here's the problem. What's the best way to go about it? And sometimes I use it just for ideas.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of days I'm either buried doing policy or, you know, random stupid things like that. And so
sometimes I'm just like a lazy, I just don't want to do that much typing. So I'll tell it what I want it to do, and then it let it spit me 90% of the code, and then I just tweak it. Or I like to copy paste. If I can get the copy paste, I love it.
I can usually tell when it's written by AI when I do that, though. I mean, it just has like
how?
a robotic tone to it. Or to
it
me.
Can. So there are also like, there are watermarks that are like put in there, like OpenAI, like the big one you'll see with OpenAI is like in the realm of, they always use hyphens anywhere they can use hyphens. There are some very common phrases that it does throw in there for it to watermark. These things become way more powerful when you hook one or two AIs together and you've got like a generator and a checker. They become extremely powerful. The pipelines are really cool. I don't know if you mess with any like pipelines or like multi-step type of stuff, but there is a good GUI. I don't want to talk to like the, you know, the safety of it, but it's Pinocchio, one click installers. I don't, like I said, I'm not going to speak to the safety of it because I, you know, don't install it on a critical machine, but it's cool to play with. So that lowers the barrier to like deep fakes and like talking heads and all that good stuff.
No, it's like, well, here's my other problem too, is like I still go to school. You know, just partly because like schools like WGU, they have certificates built into their program.
Nice. Nice.
So the cost of me to go to school for like a year is still cheaper than what it would have cost me out of pocket to do all the certificates that came with their program.
Nice. What are you going for?
I'm there for cybersecurity and information assurance.
Nice.
So I should be done hopefully by the end of this month, and then I should be able, or I'm going to go back for my master's, which I don't think that'll take too long. It's only like 6 classes.
Nice.
And then I'm probably going to run to a PhD. And the only reason I want to do that is because for cybersecurity, they did something kind of interesting. So you have your technical side of cybersecurity that you could do a PhD in.
Interesting.
But a few schools have come out with a psychology of cybersecurity. And so that falls into the why people do what they do or how they act when they do that, which is, I mean, that's like the whole social engineering side of it.
Yes, and that's your specialty, is the social engineering aspect, which is interesting, because as a nerd, a lot of times it's uncommon to have that social aspect. A lot of people don't have it.
Well, so the way I did it and I learned how to do it wasn't, I spent a lot of time with my grandpa when I was growing up. I mean, he was a car dealer.
Nice.
And it was a small used car lot. I think before that he owned like a service station, his little mobile one station. Actually, I still have most of his stuff on my wall right now from the That's mobile crazy. One station. In the barn, we have the old Coke machine that used to sit outside too.
That's cool.
I got it working again. It's kind of fun. There's a little push button on it now, so you can just get Cokes whenever you want to.
That's cool.
But he was a very good car salesman, and the way that he sold cars was funny. Because I'd sit in his office, and I'd be like, or someone would pull up in the lot, and he wouldn't get up. And he could sit there in his office and tell who was going to buy a car and who wasn't going to buy a car.
It's funny. He would just watch. They would watch their behaviors.
We started playing bet, or, you know, hey, I bet they're going to buy one, or they're not going to buy one. And so over time, I learned how to do it.
Yes.
And so now I'm able to actually, my social engineer stuff, I can usually tell what's going to happen next. I mean, I've walked into buildings where you ask, you know, you'd be in like the full like setup of, you know, Spectrum with, you know, your little service order and everything, and they'll say no. Usually when they say no, I go outside and start picking apart their Wi-Fi because I'm already there.
Yes.
But those ones, you can tell as soon as they speak of how far you're going to get.
Yes. Yep.
And then some of them, like my favorite time to hit people is when they're leaving for lunch or just coming back from lunch.
Because their guard's down.
So it's like my favorite ones are, if you catch them right when they're walking out for lunch, you'll get that lady that's just like right walking out or walking right out of the door. Like I'll sit there and wait till I see like someone like in the window start coming out, and then I walk in.
Yes.
And they'll even hold the door open for you, and you say, oh, and they'll see your shirt and they're like, oh, you're here for, you know, for the internet connection. I'm like, you know, users always have issues with the internet connection.
Yes.
And then I was like, yeah. And they're like, well, here, I'll walk you back, but I got to go to lunch. And so-and-so's in this office if they need you, or if you need them. What? It's like, okay.
That's awesome. So, what is the most high-pressure situation that you've been in, that you could talk about it?
I've ended up in the back of a cop car a few times.
How did that happen?
Security guards. They picked me apart. They escorted me out.
That's crazy.
One of them saw me plug stuff into, I had a little bad USB that I was rickrolling a bunch of computers with.
That's so funny.
I couldn't get anywhere, so I was like, you know what? I'm
Bad
just gonna start
USB.
walking around and stabbing stuff with the bad USB.
I say that to people. I say, if you didn't fill your USB ports with epoxy, I can get you. If you allow a keyboard and a mouse, I can get you. If a keyboard and a mouse are allowed on your computer, I can do things to it.
Another good one is it works in medical offices, especially because a lot of, like MRIs and stuff come on like CDs and stuff still,
Yeah.
which I don't get. I
Blue
really,
ISO.
I do not get the medical industry and how far back and backdated they are with stuff now. Like, I mean, HL7 started like a really nice implementation and then everyone just dropped it. So.
Because if people that don't know make the decision, that's the problem.
So, I mean, yeah, medical and legal still operate off of CD and fax machines. I mean,
My mind blowing.
so I think one time, so the way I, when I pen test, the way I view it is if I break any part of the CIA triad, then it's successful. So if I break your confidentiality, if I break the availability or the integrity or anything, then yeah, that's a win in my book.
Yes.
So a few times when I had trouble getting in places, I would send like 1,000 black pages of fax to a medical office.
That's so good.
Yeah.
Gotta get that e-fax. The e-fax.
Or,
Full black pages too. So not only are you hitting their fax machine, you're costing them money.
well, for eFax, what I like doing is I used to do phone systems, so it's really not hard for me to spoof or
Auto dialer fax.
so like what we'll do is we'll just bombard the channels because
Yeah.
eFax only allocates so many channels per client.
Yes.
So usually if you can get like 20 or 30 faxes going in at once, like large faxes, it clogs up like crazy. Just
So
for it. It's just for that client.
something that I never thought about, but very easy to DOS a fax machine. Very easy.
But there is a setting for it. That's the funniest part.
Interesting.
So
I didn't even know. I didn't even know.
Some fax machines have a max page setting, some of them have a max content setting. So, I mean, if you do fax something that's all black, it'll say, there's nothing here.
Okay.
So, fax machines got a little smarter.
Yes.
So, the other good one is, those little HP printers with wireless cards?
Oh, yeah. Oh,
I love
yeah.
those. Another good one was Nest thermostats.
Yep.
So I love thermostats and pretty much anything like that just because I pivot off of them.
Yes.
And it's not, I mean, they're IoT devices. They're not hard to spoof or pivot off of anyways. So,
Yeah, no, not at all.
and so what I'll do is that on some of them, if you unplug it, you can catch it right up when the boot up's going. And you can get on the default network and get on it that way. So, and then when it connects, it sometimes it'll drop you, but sometimes it doesn't drop you. It's kind of it's really weird.
Hit or miss.
So, but I don't know if anyone's actually done a bug report on that.
They've got all kinds of problems. They've had all kinds of problems for a long time, but people accept it for the convenience. I mean, I don't know. Like
I've done a little bit.
IoT is what it is. I like the open source stuff. The open source IoT is great. It is great.
I
But
mean,
also private VLAN, segment your network, like do it right.
my house is a Google house. I mean, I could turn lights off and off by Google,
Yep.
but I also know the risk that comes with it. I mean,
Yes.
it's segregated on its own network. It's
Yep.
When
And
it
there's
isn't.
it. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. I run a jailbroken iPhone for reasons. For reasons. I know the risks. I understand the risks. It's
I
we.
got
There you
the
go. There you go. Look, I'll tell you what it is. It's bad. But I like to watch something while I'm. I like to have something to watch while I'm driving. And if you don't have a jailbroken iPhone, it's very hard to serve YouTube up to your head unit. If you have a jailbroken iPhone, it's very easy to serve YouTube or any app to the head unit.
pixel.
I hadn't figured out how to do it on Android Auto. I haven't figured out how to do it on Android Auto, other than an Android head unit with a web browser.
Yeah. No, I mean we drive Fords around here, so they still have the SOC system in
I got a SYNC 3. I got a SYNC 3. I only drive
it.
Fords. I've got a 94 Cobra and a 2018 EcoBoost.
Oh man, we got four of them running around here. I drive an F-250 as my daily.
Nice, nice.
My wife has a new Bronco, but it took 2 years to come in because it was custom. So,
Nice. Bronco Raptor, Bronco
no, so they didn't
Skyline.
have the Raptor when we ordered that one. We ordered it when they first went on reservation,
Okay.
and it took 2 years to get it. But what it is it's a wild track, so
Okay.
it has the twin turbos in it,
Nice. Good engine.
and then we have or then we put the Badlands drivetrain underneath it, so like it has all the rock crawling features on it.
Nice.
So, the front and rear locking differentials and the whole 90-degree turn thing.
Yeah.
And so.
Gotta hit it with the tune. Cut the cats off. Put an intercooler on it.
That thing, those twin turbos
Fast.
scare you in that thing.
Fast. So you make 500, you can make 500 horsepower, 500 foot-pounds of torque pretty easily on a 3.5.
So those things were. It eats tires like crazy already.
I bet.
So, and then I have my old truck down there. It's in pieces still. It's getting a stroked engine in it, but it's an old 88 F-150
There you go.
single cab short bed truck.
Nice.
Little
What
four-wheel drive.
engine are you putting in it?
It's a 409,
Okay, nice.
351.
My
Yeah.
94 Cobra was it came 302 turbo, then it went to 351 Windsor turbo. Turbo 400 and gas is really, really expensive now. Also, E85 was hard to come by a period of time a couple of years ago, so we're back to a 302 turbo because good luck affording 1,000 horsepower at 3 miles per gallon.
And then my wife ended up with a 65 Mustang that's down there.
Nice,
But the cool
nice.
thing about that one is it has the 64 and a half color codes on it. So it's an oddball.
No, that's cool. That's really cool.
Yeah, that one is actually, we found an engine and a transmission out of a Fox body that's going into it right now.
Nice. There you go. T5 manual.
Yep.
Nice.
T5 with a little 302 in it.
That's I took out my Turbo 400. I put the T5 back in. Nice.
My truck had a C6 in it, and we're going to an E4OD. So, because
Yep.
when the C6 was in there, when you I used to drive it back and forth to San Antonio and going down the road, that thing was at like 4,000 RPM all the
That's funny.
But
That's
no,
cool.
that truck's one of those. It's a heavy half, but
Okay.
it's a short heavy half. So. When you pull the VIN number up on it, it comes back as F-150 slash F-250.
Interesting.
So, but I like it because it's the same size as an old Bronco.
Yeah.
So, and then I found or I grabbed some Super Duty axles that were also thrown underneath it too. So,
Nice. That's sweet. So you're into cars too.
when I have time, but yeah.
Yeah, it's time. It's a lot of time. I learned a decent amount about security through BMW's Cas 3 Plus setup and all the where you can store the encryption keys and where you storing them inside like the EEPROM and how to move those chips around and how just to get around their security to do things.
Before I started working from home, I had a little Mazda 3 that I tuned.
There you go.
It was like, I don't think anything was like it looks stock, but I hacked the crap out of that little ECU.
Nice. The factory ECUs nowadays are good. Like that old Mustang, I built my own Mega Squirt because that ECU is not very featured. It was like OBD 1.5. The new stuff, it's already got a wideband on it. They're great.
Yeah, I'm super lazy when it comes to the fuel injection. Like, I'm pretty much just gonna go Holley, plug and play, be done with
nothing
it.
Wrong. There's nothing wrong with that. I just like the boost and all the complicated stuff. So it's, you blow up enough engines, the EFI is nice as a peace of mind because it can save you lots of time. Lots of time.
Yeah.
The diesels, I love tuning diesels because they're easy. Just throw more fuel at it. Throw more fuel at it.
My last truck before I got this one, actually, I traded that truck for the one I have now because I blew the turbo and the transmission all in one day.
Nice.
Had a good day.
My.
But it was another Super Duty, but it was a 6.0.
Nice.
Everyone dogs on those engines, but they were all right. They just required lots of maintenance.
I've got a relationship with the Volkswagen ALH engine, which is supposed to be the most bulletproof engine. I can't tell you how many I've blown up, and I had the most impressive failure, and I still hung on to it to this day. So my piston broke off at the wrist pin. Like, it threw the top of the piston off. I've never split one that way before, and it was very impressive, but it was I had been spraying that car with methanol, turned the boost up, everything, because I ran out of fuel, and the Cummins pump, the 12 mil Cummins pump was the bigger pump, but I just, methanol will do the job. And then I was dailying it, and it had a runaway issue, and I was spinning the tires, which you should never spin the tires in a 35 horsepower car. I decided to slam the brakes to try to just like choke it out, and it went pop. Piston windowed the block, like this big bulletproof engine. So they say.
So see, in my younger days, we used to, I live out in the middle of nowhere. So in our younger days, we had nothing better to do. So
yeah,
we had a bunch of friends, and we all did, drag track in San Antonio all the time because we could. And yeah. So what we ended up doing is after, I think it started at like 6 in the morning, and I think the beer started flowing around then too.
That's
that poor car ended up with a supercharger, two turbos on it, and nitrous.
There we go. There we go.
It was all junkyard and stuff. And that poor car, we took it to the track, and then we got banned from the track with that car.
That's so funny.
Like, we took it there expecting it to just blow up.
That's funny.
And it actually ran, and we ended up selling it that night.
Good deal. Let it go before something happens.
Well, we were running it. We ran it in the like fives. Was it like a 4 or 5 down that track? And they got mad at us because there's no cage in it.
That's funny.
So the band
I'm from Metro Detroit area. Like, Woodward is really, really close to me. Street racing's always been a thing around here. I helped a buddy tune his Turbo Nova 427 Dart, and we show up at the drag strip for like one of the street events. Flip flops, shorts, and the guy comes over at tech inspection. He's looking at the car and he's like, "You got a fire suit?" No, dude, we don't have a fire suit. We race on the street. We got a helmet. He goes, "What does this thing run?" I said, "Hopefully like a 12 or a 13. It's never been on a track before, but I hope a 12 or a 13. He looks at it and he goes, "What size turbo is that?" I said, "It's an S480. He goes, "You can run the 8. You can run the 8 next time you need a fire suit."
No, we were there, and we didn't have fire suits. We had the helmet, and I was in flip-flops.
Nice.
Yeah, I ran the car flip flops. That was great.
Dude, my buddy is in dude shoes. The dude shoes, those stupid little Walmart, like, easiest to burn.
Well, I'm one of those weird people. Like, I wear flip flops everywhere. Yeah. I don't know why. It's just
like
the way.
Bare feet. Summertime, like around here in Michigan, like, it's nice, bare feet. Always ready to get out on the boat.
Now here it's summertime, it's flip flops. Most of the time when wintertime it's flip flops, just because I don't know.
Still warm. We have very cold winters in Michigan. Very cold winters.
I know. I used to spend lots of time in Michigan and
no way.
Yeah.
We're in Michigan.
All over Michigan. I think the last time I was up in Michigan, I went to Gaylord.
Nice. Yeah. My family, like, I frequent that area. Boyne Mountain was one of our customers, one of our clients, but it's also one of my favorite place.
Up there, when I got in, like, I flew in super late that night. I flew in through Green Bay. It drove.
Yep.
And
you went up through the UP.
Yeah, and I got there at 1 in the morning, and the only thing open was this little bar. But the special that they had, I always remember, because what it was it was egg raviolis with horseradish sauce. I don't know if it's because it's so late and I was so hungry or what, but that was like the best meal I ever had.
Funny.
But yeah, no, and then Wisconsin, I was always up in like Milwaukee.
Okay.
We had clients in those areas, so I'd go and take care of stuff and fly back.
Nice. Yeah, I don't go to Wisconsin too much because it's way up through the UP, and if I'm gonna go that far, I'm gonna go to Colorado. I'm not gonna. There's nothing for me. There's nothing for me in Wisconsin.
So I think one time I drove around the whole Great Lakes. So yep. I started off in Milwaukee, went through Green Bay everywhere, all the way up through that big. I forgot what the big bridge is up there.
Mackinac Bridge.
Yeah,
Mackinac Bridge.
Drove all the way around. I think I ended up in Canada almost.
That's funny. Yeah, we can get over to Windsor from where I'm at pretty quickly, pretty easily. But since 2019, I haven't gone there. Or since before 2019, I haven't ever gone back to Canada.
Yeah, and then you drive through the forest, and every single little break in the forest is the same as the motel with the little restaurant.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, it's still a lot of space in Michigan. There's a lot of space for people in Michigan. We're not running out of space here, that's for sure.
Texas is getting kind of crowded.
Is it?
Oh yeah.
I think I would like Texas.
It's not bad. It's pretty expensive right now. That's
really.
Oh yeah. So it's. I think my property taxes went up over the last 3 years. We're up like 60 or 70%.
I was building houses before I was in tech, and the house I was building in the neighborhood around me was like a very nice quality home for 200 grand. That same house is 600 now, all day.
So
all day.
See, we own this like outright, like we don't have payments on it. So
yeah.
So it's kind of like one of those, we're kind of stuck with it.
Yeah, because you got low taxes and everything. You go somewhere else, now you're paying a big tax bill.
Yeah, so. Well, I figured, you know, until the world's in a better spot, I'm probably going to sit out here in the middle of nowhere and stay happy.
It's not a bad place to be. I don't know, man. I don't know if Michigan is going to be the best place to be long term, but I hope it is. I hope so. I really do. So. Well, cool, man. I appreciate you jumping on today and giving us so much of your time. I had another 6 o'clock meeting. I was blown off, which is fine. Or excuse me. Yeah, 6 o'clock meeting. I'm like half hour late for. But I appreciate you jumping on today. Any final words?
No, other than, I mean, if y'all are looking to protect stuff, go after policy, go after training. I mean, and always make sure you got a backup. I mean,
yeah.
some of the companies like that I still manage, it's they've gotten hit a few times. Like one was the partners merged or split apart, so we turned over the servers. And the day we turned over the servers is they got ransomware. But I was sitting here, I'm like, y'all should have had the policy to make a copy before y'all even fired it up and plugged it in.
Yes.
But I had the policy to make a copy before we left or let it go. So I had the only viable backup.
Yeah.
So
Good thing. Good thing you had it.
but I've always been like that of you can hit us with ransomware, do whatever, but the thing is A, we shut it down quickly, B, we have backups.
Yes. And you got to be sure, like, those backups aren't connected to the internet, right? Like sometimes it's smart to have some stuff that's not connected. Sometimes that's smart.
So you got to make it to where you. So the way I like doing it is we back up to NAS, NAS uploads to cloud, and then
Yeah.
there's also a physical copy that gets copied from that NAS that somebody takes home every week.
Yes. Yes. Because now that's, I was like, cold, it's like cold storage backup. It's not going to get affected. It's not going to jump from the cloud to the NAS or vice versa.
And granted, it's a week, but you know, losing a whole week of data is better than losing all data.
Yes.
So,
Yes.
that's the way I've always looked at it.
It's just, a lot of people are virtualized and things like that now, remote too. Like, protect your hypervisor. You don't want to get hyperjacked. And a lot of people are very reckless with those admin credentials.
Oh, well, yeah. I like it when they make random network connections. That's my favorite. Hey, it's shooting off this weird VLAN tag. What's it do?
Yeah. Some of this stuff is just, look, when you've got big organizations and things like that, like you need somebody like yourself coming in there poking around with a stick, because your IT team's got to keep that ship running. Like, and they're going to have blind spots. They're all.
Well, and that's the other thing is we run into it all the time where somebody just wants a pat on the back. Oh, hey, we got a pen test and they didn't get anything. Great.
Yeah.
But that's not what we're here for.
Yes. And the reality is, like, look, not everybody's fully is secure, but the smart organizations know what their vulnerabilities are, and they know what they can do to take steps to correct it.
Right. And I mean, when you find somebody to pen test something, make sure that they test policy because policy fails are a big thing.
Yes.
And it's everyone always focuses on technical, and but no one really ever focuses on policy.
Yes.
So, I mean, like I said, it's the whole CIA triad. If I can find somebody that falls out of policy at least once or twice, then we found something.
Yes.
Now, it's not trying to be damning to that employee or anything. It's just saying, hey, this employee needs training.
Yes, no, it's not, and oftentimes it's not the employee's fault. It's none of the executives. Nobody had a serious cyber awareness training. There wasn't a serious cyber
They get the little training email once a year. Hey, log into this training platform and watch a video.
mindset. Yeah, or
Answer a few questions.
I try to phish my users every so often with the most obvious phishing emails.
Oh, I'm a bad fish person. I send fish emails with the unsubscribe link as like the bad links.
Nice. Nice.
Or I found a way to actually put bad stuff in like the reply to and hide it.
That's funny. There's a, oh, just because people can't resist it, on the ceiling here, you can't see it. It's an artistic QR code. Scan to unveil the future. You can't resist it, because can you really scan that picture? You have to.
I went around one time and found a company that had a bunch of QR codes and started making my own QR codes. And
That's a good one. That's a really good one.
it wasn't anything other than to prove a point.
Yes.
And it's like,
And
I went to the ISF conference like last week it was. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, mostly like counties and government, right?
Yeah.
And after everything, it was, hey, scan this QR code and tell us how you like this thing. Like, yeah, I ain't scanning nothing, dude.
That's so funny. So Michigan has an app for it. It's called Michigan Secure. It's free. You can scan a QR code. I love going to events and scanning all their QR codes with the Michigan Secure. And here you go. You need help. Call me. Here you go. You need help. Call me. Here you go. Insecure. Call me.
I had a friend a while back send me a picture of a QR code that was on a sticker on a light post that just said free weed.
People are too curious. People are always the weak link. People are too curious, and you can't, you can't stop that. I think the more curious it is, eventually people are going to click it.
Well, and here I am. I'm the person that's going to click it just because I'm curious.
Yeah. Well, the other reality too is like people talk to me about being anonymous and things like that. I'm like, you got to change your email and your phone number. Well, I can't do that. That's the number one way you're getting tracked is your email and your phone number.
Well, that's the misconception that people are that you can be anonymous. I mean,
you can't.
So yeah, you can run through Tor, you can run through a VPN, but chances are your VPN's probably going to sell you out anyways.
Your VPN will probably sell you out. There's a lot of systems that you logged into that log that traffic when you came on there. It's just, you know, if you're doing things with a computer on the internet, there are little digital fingerprints that get left everywhere.
Well, right. And it's like even through like Tor and stuff, everyone's like, oh, you can run through Tor. And it's like,
who's operating the exit node? You don't really know what's on the other side of that.
It's like I used to work for government. I know that the government owns a lot of exit nodes and entry nodes. I mean,
why wouldn't they?
They even have sites on it. I mean,
yeah. Often they take over sites, they hijack them because why wouldn't they?
So, I mean, I would if I was the government.
Yeah.
I'd be one of the biggest operators. Why not?
Use a carrier pigeon. Old school. I don't know if you saw the new Mission Impossible, but it was really interesting. Like, you get to the end of the movie, you don't know what's real. They don't know what's real. They don't know what's fake. And like deep fakes and all that kind of stuff. Like, there's a reason why sometimes like I will post like my podcast and stuff up on like a blockchain with a, you know, NFT token gate. You know, I posted it. You know, it's the real deal. You know, it's the real file. You're on somebody else's server, like, you know, who's to say somebody can't just hijack your channel and just upload deep fake videos of you doing things easily? Yeah. Like, and fool everybody.
It's like what I do on like LinkedIn sometimes. Like, I'll post like some random stupid thing. Like, I think the last time I did the when Proton Mail turned over a bunch of records. I put it with the comment of, this is why I run my own email servers. And the comment section is like insane of, well, yes, they can get it. And I'm like, here's the problem is, if I'm running an email server, you probably don't know who owns it.
Yes.
So, I mean, if I'm doing that, you know, then I'm using like a throwaway machine, like, you know, these little,
yeah,
cheap Dells that you get off of Amazon. Oh, there you go. That you get off of Amazon for $100.
Dude, someone's like telling me like old hardware is obsolete. I'm like, fire up a server on that old laptop. They're great. They're great for running servers on. They're awesome. Well,
I mean, it has an i7. It has a V-chip in it. It has 32 gigs of RAM. Why not?
Yeah, no, they're efficient. They're efficient. It's got a little battery on it. You can't beat it a lot of times.
It's cheap, so if I have to chunk it or throw it away.
Own your own infrastructure, the cloud is somebody else's hardware.
Or a lot of times, like, I go after child predators a lot because, I don't know, I get bored. And my theory is, if I'm making someone's life miserable, at least it's somebody that deserves it.
Yeah.
I mean... And
look, nobody's gonna fault you for target practice on child predators. Nobody. If they do, that's pretty suspicious.
Well, I mean, plus usually with like, I start a conversation with one, usually I record it and stuff and make sure, like, I turn over like that's like my third or fourth laptop because I think the I had to turn over like a few of them over to the authorities. It was like, here's all the information. I don't want
Yeah.
it.
Man, it's people out there nowadays too, they're making videos of them doing things that are illegal. People just don't care. And that's the thing is like if you could take simple steps to anonymize yourself a little bit because there're just so many other people out there that are just reporting themselves.
Well, and it's like every Christmas I try to do around holidays, I try to do this thing because there's a bunch of Twitter sites of people that just scrape like Instagram, Facebook for like family pictures, right?
Yeah.
And then the captions that they put with those pictures are insane. Like, oh, I'll do the mom while the daughter watches and shit like that.
Yeah.
And so, like, I'll copy those and like take screenshots and I blur out all the faces, obviously, because
Yeah.
no one should be subject to that anyways.
Yeah.
And then I track down the people in the photo and say, hey, just so you know, this is out here.
Yeah. Man, that's it, and it's that kind of stuff, like this deep fake stuff. This sucks. This sucks for a lot of kids because a lot of times these are like fake photos, generated photos, things like that, but they look unbelievably real. And this is something that like to a young person or a family can destroy reputations, destroy somebody's
Hopefully
mentality,
they,
like.
hopefully we make it a point to never fix the finger or the teeth bug.
Fixed. It's fixed. It's already fixed.
Oh, I know.
It's already fixed. They're more real than real. Like I just posted one on my LinkedIn today. This dude blew up because he used open source AI to take the Joker, put it on Lil Yachty's body, jumping up and down on a stage. Like it's at that level where it's that good. It does the teeth, it does the facial recognition. It's an animated talking head from an audio clip just like that.
I mean, I think eventually we're gonna have to go back to the days of person-to-person meetings for
Yeah.
anything confidential or financial.
Man, if only somebody figured out a way to like build identity into the internet, it might solve a lot of our problems.
It would. It'd be, I don't know if I want the internet to have my identity though.
But if you knew what identities were when you were accessing certain things, there are certain things that are valuable to have an identity. But I'm not saying identity like the OpenAI is the one who does it with the proof of personhood. I'm not necessarily saying they're the ones who need to do it, but differentiating between human and bot traffic, like bots are necessary. They are necessary and they're out there. But to know there is value to knowing what's real and what's not, not real. Like face to face, there is value in face to face. There is value in real humans.
Well, then we have to go back to like. Was it like not too long ago? There's a Chinese firm that got like a few million dollars released
Oh
because
yeah.
they faked the being like a financial officer or some stupid thing. And
Man, this is funny. So I thought it was kind of bullshit until I actually like did the research and looked into it that you could figure out with a long enough audio file, you can figure out somebody's keystrokes from the audio. And I'm like, how the fuck do you figure out audio or how do you figure out keystrokes from the audio? It's actually like a timing based attack on which keys you're clicking.
Well, it's like the RF or well the authentication by gate. Have you ever seen one of those systems where it'll open a door for you by the way that you walk? Because everyone's gate is different.
Interesting. I mean, like gates and doors, the age old trick of like tinfoil on the sensor, spraying your compressed air upside down to fool that automate. Where was I at the other day where the push to exit button was literally right on the inside of the door, not on the wall on the other side. Like,
Well, and then you run into people like me that used to do alarm systems, and then you end up with all the installer codes to everything.
yeah. I mean, people talk about dark fiber and things like that. It's like, hey, look, actually having equipment from the telco, it's a liability because if I know what firewall you have, if I know what router you have, there's a CVE on that. There's a way that I can get in. You just gave me the keys to the kingdom. If I don't know what equipment you have, I can't tell what equipment you have. It makes my job significantly harder.
Well, and it's like, that's why I always advocate for people to, like, anything that's opened up to the web is to, like, run it off of reverse proxy or through a pretty hefty, web application firewall or anything like that.
Yeah.
The reason being is because if you're not, then we know your IP address.
Yes.
And I know most people are like, oh, you can't do anything with an IP address. And it's like, yeah,
yes, you can.
Surprise. Like, what was it? One of the worst ones was I ran into someone that had a SMVP or SNMP running, was V3. There's a bug with it where the authentication runs outside of the encapsulation. And it's only hashed with MD5. So, I mean, it's nothing to break it. And then they're like, well, it's IP-based security. I'm like, okay. I can spoof IPs, dude.
All day.
I mean, it's not like it's rocket science. At some point, it's just this second nature. I mean,
it's crazy.
Like, you can't spoof an IP on a public web. And I'm like, all I have to do is have a machine directly connected.
Yeah.
So I just go fire up a VM somewhere and woohoo.
Done. Done.
Is it just altering like what, one or two packets? Oh no.
Yeah, I've got one factor of authentication here, which is IP.
And yeah, great. You have a password on it, but
or
because the way that it runs and it doesn't run username and password inside the encapsulated packet. Guess what?
Yeah, or I've got two factor. But oh shit, my phone just stopped working and I've been getting all these weird emails. I'm like, I have no service on my phone anymore. What happened there? Oh, AT&T somebody swap a SIM for me.
That's where Evil Jinx is really nice too. So
what's Evil Jinx? I don't know what that is.
Or Evil Nginx or something. I can't remember. I never pronounce it right. So what it is you can use it in conjunction with GoFish, but you could build these little fishes. They call them fishlets.
Yeah.
And so what you could do is you can grab the cookies from like a Microsoft or a Google login from there.
Yeah. And then use the cookies to authenticate.
You have the cookie and then you can just put the cookie on your browser and log into their stuff like it's nothing.
Yes. Yes, because you're carrying that authentication token. You own the token for X amount of time.
I've done that in like coffee shops before. Like, if I was testing a company and there's a nearby coffee shop, because everyone went to the coffee shop at least one point in the day.
Yes.
And a lot of people don't know this about phones, but phones always call out for a Wi-Fi network.
Yes, they do.
They call out for anything that's connected before. So if you do something stupid, like put like their company's Wi-Fi as like your access point or you put like AT&T Wi-Fi or whatever, because all AT&T phones always connect to AT&T Wi-Fi just by default.
Yeah.
And things like that. Then,
that's so funny.
Then you already have them there. So from there, you just say, you send that package of, hey, log into your email again, you know.
Yeah.
And here they are.
Dude. One more time. That's so funny.
Another one is I like shoulder surfing. So like I'll go a few times I've intentionally locked out somebody's email account because I knew they went to like the cafe or to a coffee shop. So I would just sit there and wait for them to come in and I'd block their accounts. And so then they'd have to, you know, do their whole MFA thing, right? So I'd sit there and I'd be like, right before they could do it, I typed it in faster than they could.
Oh, that's pretty good. That's like pretty good. That's pretty good. There's always a way. There's always a way.
But like, again, like I said, again, then it goes back to social engineering.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a nut. I've got this keyboard here because it has quiet keys on it.
I have that one right here, too. I have the same keyboard.
That's funny. It has quiet keys on it.
That one's
But
plugged into, so
look.
I have my old computer's hard drive in one machine, and then I have a machine that's just set up for testing, because
Yep.
cert tests, most tests and stuff, they're pretty invasive, so I just have a dedicated machine just for testing.
Yep.
And so that's what I use that keyboard for. Also, too, it streams movies all day, so it just kind of sits over there.
Yeah,
It's just.
people don't really realize too how bullshit the dongles are that
But
you
my
can act these
favorite
keyboards too.
keyboard is this guy right here. Ah, it's two pieces. Ah. But yeah,
Nice.
it's a Cloud 9. It has been
That's
my,
cool.
it's noisy. That's my only problem complaint with it, but it's been a
I
nice
like, I
keyboard.
enjoy the noisy peep. I like that.
Well,
But
the Cloud 9s, you can select how loud they are. Like, you can change out the mechanics in it if you really wanted to.
this is a very cheap Red Dragon. I was going to build my own keyboard, and then this one was so cheap, and I was going to modify it and just never did because it worked great for me.
No,
So.
I when I worked at the county, we used to have an assistant clerk, I think she was, had this old ratted out keyboard. It was as the pre PS2 connections,
Yeah, PS2s.
but the pre ones, the big giant one that looked like a PS2, but it wasn't a PS2. I forgot the name of it.
I don't remember what it was before PS2, but
Had to
I
have
just know
like
I tried.
three adapters on that thing to get it to work
Yep.
on the new computer. And
That's so
but she
funny.
would never give it up. Like, it was the noisiest freaking keyboard and had holes in the keys from like just wear.
That's funny.
Now I'm sitting here, I'm like, I'm not even mad, because if I had a keyboard like that, I'd probably keep it too.
Some people prefer it. I mean, look, you used to do phones and stuff. I do a lot of phones for businesses, phones, internet. I do everything. All things business tech, from the colo to the software that runs on the computer. So I see a lot of stuff, and there are people that are particular to their old stuff, and it's just like it is what it is. People prefer things. Let them use it.
Well, it's like, what was it? I came across it not too long ago. There's an old 3 comp switch still running. I mean, it's a gig switch, it still ran. I'm
Yeah.
just it had VLANs and everything on it, and I'm like, you should probably swap that out. And it's like, but it runs and I like it. I'm like,
I love when I go in, I'm just like, yeah, everything looks pretty good other than that antique switch with one power supply in it that's feeding your entire infrastructure there. Like a couple $100 would go a long ways.
I mean, I don't know. Some of these new switches, the price point's insane on them right now.
Oh, there, look. Build your own. Build your own if it's that expensive. What? That's it.
I know, but some of the management consoles on these new ones are
They're
so nice.
nice. They're nice. But I'm not gonna lie. Like there are some times where it's like SD-WAN vendors and stuff will talk about things, and I'm like, look, for a lot of people, you can get an ASUS router and do a basic load balance and throw a SIM card in it. And you're gonna hate me for saying it, but for a lot of people, that's okay. Like some of these ASUS routers have Trend Micro Security built into them. A
Well,
lot of them are decent and they're like $40. Like, what are you selling me for $2,000 a month?
it's like me. Like, a lot of people dog on me because I still run a lot of Ubiquiti gear. And
I
it's like,
like Ubiquiti, but this year I had an instance where I was getting notifications for other people's equipment. And
there
they
was,
fixed it. They did fix it, but I experienced that.
but I had a, I mean, I, they're cheap, and the management consoles like
I
decent,
like Ubiquiti.
and they work. I mean, their new line's kind of nice. I'm not gonna lie. The whole LED lights and stuff, where you can trace stuff out.
Yeah, it's it, where it does a little snake game and all that too. Yeah, those are
Yeah,
cool. They're cool. They are cool, but also like with those sophisticated, like I love it when somebody tells me, yeah, I've got like old firewalls that are easily compromised. I'm just like, unplug it. Just quit using it. It's a gateway.
my favorite is the old Sonic wall and the old WatchGuard firewalls everywhere.
Oh man, it kills me. I had a client that was, they had that old on-prem Exchange email server with those firewalls, and the email server was in Germany and they're in Michigan. You would send a reset code sometimes. Sorry if you're listening to this. You would send a reset code to it sometimes, and it would take like 45 or 50 minutes for it to make that round trip. And I've got some other organizations right now where their point of sale is hooked up to those. And not only that, the point of sale company does their virtual machines through there, and they've got a virtual machine in all these restaurants on these old ass firewalls.
I think the worst network I ever installed is when we had contracts with Office Depot, because we did two buildings. They come in on a board, like pre-configured.
Yep.
But they were like the cheapest equipment. And then just like, it's pre-configured, so I mean, you just plug it in and hope it works.
when it comes to like pre-configured stuff, the most impressive I've seen, I don't know, it will be mad for if I say this, AWS, you can see it in some of my videos. AWS ships out their hyperscaling nodes. They come in these thick metal cabinets. So like, compared to a regular cabinet, it's like three times as thick on the metal. They're crazy looking, and they're like a tannish color. But they put them right on the main, you know, public area data center floor and put AWS on them. So they must be very confident with their, you know, their security. But they ship to the data center that way. Plug them in and they're good to go.
Oh no, data center work was always fun.
Oh, I love it. It's fun. It
the
is
coolest
a lot of fun.
Data center I've ever been in is in Dallas.
It's Which in, one?
I can't remember the name of it, but it's in an old Federal Reserve building. So the Carrier Hotel is actually located in the old safe.
Wow, that's sweet.
And then the rest of the whole building is just data center.
That's sweet.
So, but it's like Fort Knox going in there. It's like they kept all the security intact and everything.
Coolest stuff that I see is all the crypto stuff, or like the AI compute. The cooling for the AI compute and the crypto stuff is crazy. The two-phase immersion cooling is nuts.
So about 2 years ago, I did electrical for a while. It was one of my break times. I was at the Microsoft data centers.
That's so big power, I'm sure.
I was in the, oh no, it was a beautiful site. It was air conditioned all summer. It's heated in the winter.
That's cool.
I mean, the management company or the contracting company had this rule on, or it's actually a Microsoft rule. You couldn't carry anything longer than 10 feet without two people. You could,
funny.
You had to have a permit for a ladder, so everything was on scissor lift.
That's so
like most of the day you just spent driving around scissor lifts, or if you got really tired, you just go, hey, I need to go get some pipe. And, you know, you grab like a little half-inch stick of pipe and two people because it's 10 feet long.
That's funny. That's cool.
But, yeah, no, I was doing the controls for the generators and the battery systems.
That's cool. My experience with the colo is like, hey, how much power can I get in the cabinet? They tell me how much power I can get in the cabinet. And then I come in there and I say, you guys got cooling here? Yeah, we've got good cooling here. I bring stuff in. By the time I bring my stuff in, everything is overheating and they're making changes. The whole room just went down. I wasn't kidding when I told you I was going to pull 200 amps 24/7.
Their cooling units for the data center were probably just about the size of the actual like data center. Like,
woo!
Like outside the data center, you had the big old air conditioners. Then they were pretty cool. Like the whole bottom side was cooling. So that pumped in, and then like his typical data center, they had the hot aisle in the middle. And, you know, servers were pointed in, so everything's going up. So it sucked in all the hot air from the hot aisles from the top, because it just went up into the ceiling. Yep. And then, you know, it blew like a massive amount of cold air. When they would fire them on, it would drop down to like 40 degrees in that data center.
That's cool. That's crazy.
And then the battery center systems that we had to hook up, holy crap. They could supply the racks and the air conditioning with enough power for like, was it like 2 minutes?
That's a lot of power.
And each UPS system, the way that they were configured is they had, it was A, B, C, and D.
Yeah.
So each number had its own electrical and its own generator and its own battery system.
That's cool.
And everything was redundant. So one data center goes off, or like one, like the, like let's say one thing goes completely offline, it just switches to the other side.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it was insane. Yeah. And then is it their specs where they build one data center every 3 days or something like that? Like
worldwide. That's so nuts.
It's like, this insane. And then we had the special data centers where you could only build half of it, and then another company had to build the other half.
It's interesting.
They do that usually for military. Back in the day when I used to run telecom, we did missile silos, and so what you had to do is you ran half of it, and then another company picked up the other half.
That's funny. That's smart. I got not like an argument, but kind of like an exchange with an IT director for a defense company that does like EMP stuff. And I was talking to him about Zoom, and he was using Teams, and I was like, look, when it comes to security, like especially with what's going on with Microsoft right now, do you really think you're better off with Microsoft than Zoom? And he goes, well, no, it's my clientele. They would prefer that I have Teams. Security wise, no, I'm not disputing it. It's probably better. My data is probably safer with Zoom than it is Microsoft.
At this point, I'd honestly say that probably Google and Zoom are probably the two better secured ones.
Dude, kind of like pains me to say it, because like we want to say like Microsoft, American company, right? But they can't get it together. They're too AI crazy. They forget about everything else.
Well, like their last breach was basically their C-suite, though. You have to admit that.
Yeah.
And just because they didn't want MFA.
So dumb.
But what kills me about that whole situation is like y'all didn't even have. I mean, they brute forced the accounts. So that means y'all
didn't have brute force protection turned on. Like you forgot your password that much, you were putting it in 100 times. It looked normal. It looked normal for somebody to be doing that.
So I'm like sitting here, I'm like, how did nobody put that up? And now y'all are sitting here saying you're pushing out like SOC and SIEM gear, you know? And it's like, I don't know, yes, if I'll take that.
I mean, look, if your SOC just sees you typing in your password 3 times a week, 100 times, because you're a moron, it's going to think that's regular behavior. Like, it's not, if you don't fix your habits and you're not being secure, it's not going to, the monitoring's not going to do you any good.
That's when you fix your controls. I've done that a few times where people couldn't remember their password, so we either gave them a YubiKey or started making biometric.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't have an option. I mean, it's better than them writing down their password.
Yeah, for sure.
Or calling me every day saying that they got locked out.
Yes.
Yeah, so
no.
It's like, here, just plug this in, you'll be good.
The user can't be trusted. The user can never be trusted. The employees can't be trusted.
But again, that it goes to the pain skill or this pain skill gaps, you know.
Yes. I mean there's skill and knowledge gaps. Like a lot of people really aren't aware. And I think there has been a lot of snake oil insecurity, and there still is a lot of snake oil insecurity, which is why people are skeptical.
Well, yeah. And it doesn't help that we have all these like little schools running around of you can make $200,000 a year to be a cybersecurity analyst. Yeah. You know, it's like what I think one of them was like Merit America or something like that. Here, come take this little basic cert and you can make $160,000 a year. Like, yeah.
You still gotta sell it to somebody, right? There's gotta be a buyer for what you're doing.
But then again, it's like, I mean, the face of disappointment would probably be when they first get their first job offer in cybersecurity.
I would not want to work in a SOC. That's a grueling job, sitting there looking at screens all day.
I don't mind IR that much. I don't like it, but I'll do it. But no, I like breaking things.
Me too. I like breaking things. I like hacking things. I like that it doesn't want me to do something and I can do it.
It's like you should see it. It's like whenever I'm like trying to go something, especially stuff that doesn't have like a CVE or a known vulnerability, and
Yeah.
you get that one response that's a little bit different,
Yeah.
and then you're just like,
Or my favorite is go to the FCC's website and find the UART port, get in there and just, I'm gonna get my own firmware on here today. I don't
Well,
even need to brute force your, I don't even need to brute force your password anymore. Here we go.
or what was the worst one I ever did was I reloaded a firewall. I found a server that I was able to use that was right next, it was next door neighbors to the other one. So what I
Yep.
did is set up a TFTP server on it, and the CVE was just reboots. That was all you could really do was the CVE. So I rebooted it and then forced the TFTP server to grab it on its boot up and reloaded the
Nice.
firmware.
Nice. There you
I
go.
was like, well, I guess it worked.
Yeah, it's if you can get physical access to somebody's machine, you can almost always do something if you can get that physical access.
Like when you get that one annoying user that like sends in the tickets of, I need this software, I need this software, and you just give up and give them like local admin.
Yes.
Oh, I love those people.
They don't even know what's, they don't even know what's going on in their own computer. They have no clue.
Where it's like I like looking at the firewall logs and it's like, hey, why does this user have like all this traffic? It's
That's funny.
like they're 90% of your traffic. What's going on with them?
Or do, this isn't even, I mean, I guess I would consider it nefarious. I work a lot of bars and restaurants too. I take people over to like fire sticks and streaming quite often. I recommend using a fire stick over a regular smart TV because oftentimes what I'll see on the network traffic, if you use regular smart TVs, all of a sudden it's just yanking all your download and all your upload. Just uploading stuff to LG or Samsung, just yank the whole pipe.
I
All the
do that.
time on Wi-Fi with no way to limit it.
I d well, QoS and DNS blocking is
Yeah.
one. I mean, yeah, granted, you probably won't get updates for a while, but eh.
Fire stick, put the bandwidth limiter on there. It'll pull 3 meg. It'll pull 3 meg, and that's all it'll do. And the smart TV, they're just not that reliable. The Samsungs are okay. Samsungs are okay, but when you get like 50 screens in one spot, if you're just like if you got a remote for each screen, you're just a you're wasting your time. You should talk to it.
I'm still an idiot with like a flipper. Like I see TVs and I just turn them off.
That's funny. I love it.
Or what is it? I found this one. Oh,
I don't have a flipper. I need a flipper.
it's like the best toy ever. I call it a toy. I've used it to brute force access control before.
There you go.
Yeah, it was. I found this little guy. I don't know if you see him. It's a little USB-C IR transmitter.
Nice. So go on your phone.
Yeah.
Nice.
And it
Yep.
came with this nice, cute little carry pouch to stick on your keys.
The Galaxy S4 Active had IR on it. I used to mess with the TVs with those old Galaxies. I mean, that's another way to do it. Like, get some old Android hardware that has it and just download it. But, like, it's funny to me that they're banning flippers and all that. It's like a Raspberry Pi will do 90 times the damage.
Or, well, it's like you're banning the flipper, but have you ever heard of a half RF?
Yeah.
I mean,
Yeah. Or shit for the bad USB, I will often have Chat GPT write my payloads. And it does a really good job. Hey, take this ducky script and convert it for me and then add this feature. Here's what I want. Here's what I want my bad USB to do when I plug it in.
well, what I like doing with the flipper is it doesn't work so much in the wintertime because we don't wear, coats and stuff.
Yeah.
But in the wintertime, I'm usually wearing my hoodie all the time anyways. So, like, I have a super long USB cable and I run it down my sleeve.
Nice.
Just walk around and go, poof.
Leave it fully powered. That's
And
cool.
no one ever notices. And so, like when we're pen testing, I just walk around and just plugging stuff in all the time. And nobody says anything.
No, nobody notices. It's funny. I got somebody here in my office one day. I put an extension cord, like just a micro USB on my bad USB to hide it. And he's got messy cords on his desk. I knew that he wouldn't notice. And I'm just I'm just waiting for the right time and I'm fucking with him. He goes to click on something. I'm just wiggling the mouse just when he's trying to do it from my phone. I'm just sending it the command. Just every so often I'm wiggling the mouse and he's looking at me all morning. He's trying to figure it out. He can't figure it out. So then I start messing with him. I pulled him onto a website. I think it was Midjourney's website. If you've been on Midjourney's website, it looks similar to your website. A bunch of ones and zeros pop up. I sent him to that page, and that's when he figured out that something was going on. He went to that page, slams it shut. What just happened to my computer? I know it was you. I know you did something. The ones and zeros is what scared him. But that's not what the hack looks like. Most of the time, you don't notice the hack.
We had, it was a little Chinese, like a little USB key like that, right?
Yeah.
This one's a Wi-Fi one, but anyways, it had the capability to basically run it as, it had firmware on it that you can make run like that USB. So I used to stick it in. This is bad. I used to work in an office at a medical company, and the most fucking annoying person in the world. Like, this lady was like the absolute worst. Like, okay,
what was her position there in the office?
She was a billing manager, but here's the problem. So billing was responsible for answering phones. Like, anyone that goes to the billing department by default.
Nice.
Customers started complaining they weren't getting calls, right? And so I'm like, okay. So I pulled the logs and I'm like, the show's call ended. So that means y'all either picked up and hung up or hit do not disturb. So I had my worker, or my little tech guy, I had him sit in the network closet because it was at the back of the building. And he'd sit there and call in, and he was videotaping them. And they were just hitting the do not disturb button.
That's so funny.
And so she started going, well, the phones aren't working, because we're not getting calls and people are complaining. I'm like.
And you can see it on your end. I watched the call come in, and you reject it.
So we're in the CEO's office, and I had the phone logs with me. And I was like, here's the logs, here's the video. And then she started this. They're just making that up. I'm like, you're off the freaking video, lady.
Here's the log. Here's the video. Here's the video.
And she started the whole, well, you make up logs. I'm like, lady, I don't have the time to make up logs. That's a lot of effort that I don't care to do.
Fair point. Fair point on her part. Smart. Accuse you of making up the logs.
Well, that's why we had the video. We protected ourselves.
Yeah. Put those logs on Polygon, get a little immutable record going.
to pay back, I had that little USB key. I stuck it in the back of her computer. And you know that old video, like it's just like a, hey, turn the volume up and watch this, and it's, you know, like a pretty obscene sound that comes on?
Yes.
So the payload on that one was every time she opened up a window, that sound would go off at max volume in the middle of the office.
Oh, that's pretty good. Dude, I got somebody one time with the USB plugin for Windows, right? I changed the audio file. You plug the USB in, it'll play the default sound. It waits 15 minutes. And then after 15 minutes, because it was a really long audio file, it played Garth Brooks' I Got Friends in Low Places, the full song. And if you go to log out, like go to the logout screen, because it's a Windows sound, it will keep playing. But it's so hard to detect, and it would take people so long. It's my favorite one, because it's so hard to trace down, because you plug it in, you get in the middle of doing something, 15 minutes later, it comes on full volume at you. And I've done it with all kinds of things, but the Garth Brooks one was fun. And my friends won't let me touch their computers. They ban me. And I tell them all the time, like, I don't need to touch it to mess with you guys. I don't even need to touch it.
Well, it's like it was at the same company. I was playing a joke on one of the doctors. So and back then it was Windows XP still. So. I found the register keys where you could make a sound whenever somebody clicks. You could set it to a WAV file. So every time he clicked something, it was Rick James going, oh, yeah, yeah.
frustrated that makes people with computers and know nothing about computers because they don't even know what
to think. It was every click. And then he sent in the ticket, and I waited like a day. And so I was like, I'm not done yet. So I found the register keys where you could set Windows or the keyboard keys, or every time a keyboard key hit to make the same sound. So now it's every keyboard key and the mouse doing the same sound.
That's so funny.
He came back to the office and just threw that thing on our desk. I hope
that you told him it's because of the websites that he was going to.
Well, that's the thing. It's like we saw all the network traffic. It's like, we know you watch Netflix 90% of the day, so
yeah.
We're just gonna have fun anyways.
It's so funny. That's my favorite excuse when I do something to somebody. I tell them, stay off those sketchy websites, man. That's how you keep getting it. It's the websites that you're going to.
I like doing it in front of somebody's manager because just the look of the manager's face of what's going on.
That's pretty good. Well, hey, man, I appreciate you jumping on today. Thank you so much.
So, yeah.